marker, tail slate, second sticks.
Second sticks.
There was a burnout in the middle of the 90s when for a while nobody wanted to see a guitar. Nobody wanted to hear about rock. It was like, you know, grunge, stop, don't talk about it anymore. It's done.
We felt a backlash. Well, 1995, we put out a record, and it gets in the UK in particular, like, we were just savaged, basically, you know? And I kind of understood it, you know, like, it was after Kurt died and stuff, and, like, people just didn't want to be reminded of it.
You know, I became known as, like, you know, the grunge record producer guy. So I ended up getting a lot of really terrible sound-alike wannabe bands, mostly from L.A.
You know, in my mind, I started calling us a grunge band, just, like, to... But like, if anyone is, we are. Like, you know, like, because like a lot of bands were like,
we have the dirty guitars.
Yeah, like, so I was like, fuck it, we're grunge. and that went over like a wet fart.
Here's what happened. You know, everybody got their major label deal. Some of the bands did. You know, a lot of them didn't. But the ones who did, and of course, you know, you had the Melvins on a major label, Mudhoney's on a major label, Tad's on a major label. Labels didn't know what to do with this stuff. They had no idea. You know, and what always happens is A&R person gets fired, bands get dropped, you know, and then they either, you know, they go home demoralized and go, well, that was our shot, we're done, or they pick themselves up, keep making records, which is what all those people I just mentioned ended up doing.
What was great that a lot of us and our friends got to kind of ride the wave for a while, you know, like, you know, Flop was on a major label and got to tour, and, you know, Love Battery got to tour all over, you know, like things like that. So I'd say it's from our little world, and that, you know, a lot of us got to have a great time.
To me, it was just this super big highlight, you know, that happened, sort of like this big flame. Well, that happens again. It maybe not isn't grunge, but it'll still continue in Seattle. So I don't think it destroyed the scene, and I don't think it necessarily, I mean, I guess it altered it for that period of time, definitely.
All those issues, the fame, the attention, whatever, maybe that was damaging to that particular scene, that particular body of, you know, friends and peers, but not to Seattle and music.
As the internal optimist, I think that there has been, continued to be, the next generation. They could have come along 5 years after these guys, 10 years, now 20, some of them 30. and new music has come out of here.
From my standpoint, I see once again a whole new generation of rock bands here in Seattle. I mean, there's some amazing bands I've been working with.
The concept of, like, this thing is dead gets thrown around way, way too easily.
No, it didn't die. There was no way that we ever thought it could just burn without, you know, supernova for even as long as it did.
The scene, especially by 2017, looks like a bunch of stories about bands that got signed and put out records. And what your documentary really says, no, the scene is about all of these bands. And some of them are, you know, less serious, you know. But, you know, the energy is still, you know, people still turn out to see them.
Arguably, there's more stuff happening now than ever.
Many of the people that you talked to in the movie originally 20 years ago are still performing. I mean, Celine from Seven Year Bitch is still playing shows. Tad has got a band. Leighton is still playing. Van Conner is working on a solo record. I just did a record, mixed a record for Gary Lee Conner from the Screaming Trees. Of course, Mark Lanegan is out there still playing. He's making some of the best work that he's done. We're lifers.
We've never stopped playing, really. We did a lot of touring the last few years, actually. Went to Europe a lot and Australia. And a few weekends ago, we played a little outdoor show in Georgetown. And it was like high school reunion, you know? There were so many of us at the show and so many bands playing with our people.
And their children.
and their children watching.
These are the bands that I've played in over the last 12 months or so. If you love music, you'd rather, you know, sit at home and watch TV or get together with your friends and scheme up a band, throw ideas together. It's like, we gotta do this. Does it not pay anything? Do you have to learn a whole bunch of complicated songs very quickly? And do you have to wear an uncomfortable outfit? If you get all those things, then yes, it's the show. It's what you need to do. Tonight it's a BTO, Bachman Turner Overdrive cover band.
Here's a great recent one. This was the Stooges super group that played on the top of the Pike Place Market. There's Mark, Mike McCready, Barrett, and Duff.
There are a lot of people moving here specifically after the success of a handful of bands, as a person would go up to Alaska to pan for gold. And that's still happening. You know, Sub Pop's here, great record label. There, it is a vital environment. It's a youth culture. Even if you take the music out, which you couldn't, you have things like Google and Amazon, Microsoft, and which at least will comprise an audience for the musicians.
They might not be coming here to start a grunge band, but you wish that they would, maybe.
Bowling alleys. They're all gone. I think there might be one in West Seattle now. You know, they've all turned into condos.
They move into a neighborhood, then maybe there's some houses that have bands practicing. They put up a block-long thing of condos. And yeah, we've got all this great nightlife and bohemian wonderfulness. And the first thing to go is bands practicing or a venue that has music. It's like, whoa. Those people get old fast, like over the course of a couple weeks.
Every neighborhood has their like 2 or 3 day music festival now, which to me is what killed rock and roll. You like go and have your smoked salmon and take your kids to see the, it just, you're supposed to go to the shitty club at like midnight and get fucked up and end up on somebody's sofa that you didn't know.
Ditto Tavern, Fifth Avenue, these guys playing on a stage that was about this high.
That was fun.
Bartending and managing.
And all your friends are stumbling around drunk, right. Spilling beer everywhere. I thought those were great days. I mean, it was pretty cool. I miss it in that, oh, that was a cool experience, but I wouldn't trade it. Where I'm at as a person and the relationships I have now, I would probably take over anything else in the past.
Picture of Kurt Cobain that I actually didn't really print until 2003. That was at the Seattle Center Coliseum. An image takes on a whole new meaning after the fact than when I photographed it.
One thing that kind of bummed me out about Hype is that, and I really wish you'd finished it before Kurt died, because that, all of a sudden the movie just takes a radical shift. All of a sudden there's just like this heaviness to it that, like, except for the time of his death, I didn't really feel.
For me, it was clear even then that when Smells Like Teen Spirit came out, it was like, that was the go button, and then when he died, it was the stop button. I mean, it was, you know, that's a metaphor, but it kind of was like that, you know, in terms of that movement, that grunge movement.
I was waiting for something terrible to happen, and that happened. So the idea that it became that narrative, and you know, that didn't bother me about your documentary at all.
When I spoke to you 20 years ago on my way to meet you for the filming, and I got in a call about Kurt's incident in Europe where he was found unconscious, and that began the writing on the wall and the intense invasion of privacy that none of us were ready for, really. The end of our innocence.
My first thought was, if someone would write a comic book about a music scene, it was full of all the cliches that I'd grown up with and understood in the 60s and 70s, and I didn't expect the tragic cliches to be present like that. So it went from innocence to this is crazy. This is crap I read growing up, and now it's you know, our world, our lives.
After the Hype, a lot of bands had to insulate themselves more. You know, Pearl Jam really, you know, like, we're not gonna do music videos, and it, you know, we may lose a million in sales, but we'd much rather just not do that.
They've got longevity because they've done it their way. You know, Soundgarden was totally doing it their way. They handled it, but they maintained control. They didn't burn themselves out early. They didn't make stupid decisions. You know, they kept artistic control of what they were doing, and they tried to make sure that it was still enjoyable. When it wasn't enjoyable, I mean, even Pearl Jam, they tour when they feel like it. Nobody makes them do anything.
And it was great for many of the bands to control as much of it as possible so it doesn't belong to someone else. And then you can retain the honesty and the happiness in what you're doing.
So this is Chris Cornell, which is the Sub Pop Sunday at the Vogue, which turned out to be for their first EP, the cover, Screaming Live. His voice was impressive from the get-go. You know, it was such a, we just hadn't heard that before, you know? Singing like that and just a beautiful person and shy and you know, not a rock star material at all. He was
very reserved and very private. Even back 25 years ago, he was a man of very few words, you know? Always a delightful fellow, always total sweetheart. But I think Chris's situation was a personal thing and it was unique to him, and I don't think you can draw any wider lesson from it, really. It's, you know, 25 years later.
Chris is the greatest rock singer of our generation. The music that was made of bands of all genres, so creative, so people dug so deep. Whether the world heard them or not, they were digging so deep to create something so special, and it was appreciated.
Reggie Watts, Sean Smith, Mark Lanegan, Kurt Cobain, Chris Cornell. I mean, I'm just used to everybody singing great. It's like, oh, here's another, well, set up the mic. Oh, shit, okay, it's just taking care of itself. Here's somebody else that sounds as good as anybody I grew up with on the radio, you know? And so for me, it was all these, you know, amazing vocal talents fronting all these, you know, somewhat interesting oddball bands.
And the thing about grunge is that the music, it spanned like this spectrum of rock and roll, everything from the stadium to the thrown-ups. There was something for everybody.
And it synergized. Mm-hmm. It really had an impact on all of us, certainly, but an impact on music history.
It was a certain period in time in music that I think was the last period in time like that.
Things kind of got decentralized and globalized. Nothing could formulate for years underground.
It was the last pre-internet music scene.
Now I think there's scenes that can happen, like, but it's going to be not a localized kind of scene.
I can do amazing work now for bands that I think are incredible, but they're putting it out themselves, and I know that realistically probably nobody outside their circle of friends is ever going to hear the record. At the same time, they're going to put it up on the internet, and it's discoverable by everyone in the world now. But there's no one actually promoting any of it now because we don't have that indie label infrastructure that we once had.
There isn't a music industry right now. There's this bloody Band-Aid over an injury. but there isn't a music business. It's all still sorting itself out right now. It's a jungle filled with like amateurs, and it's very hard to find any real music.
You make vinyl records, do you not make vinyl records? You make MP3s, do you sell CDs? Do you put things on YouTube? Do you Spotify?
Actually, there's been a cassette revival of sorts, which is also even weirder to me. The sound quality is terrible. I don't get it.
This is me when I was 17. This is in my bedroom in Bothell.
When was the last major worldwide explosion of music coming from a specific geographical region? I can't speculate on why that would be the case, other than maybe we just had a lot of really good music here. Maybe it just was recorded well. I don't know, you know?
People still love music. Well, electric guitar is dying and guitar bands, it's like a baloney.
Right on the other side of that wall, Alice in Chains is making a record.
That's right now.
And we're gonna walk over there and say hi to them.
I think a lot of it depends on like how you look at things. I mean, I don't feel like I've ever been disappointed by any setbacks to my career or anything like that. You know, like,
it was all gravy.
It's all super, super lucky. And I mean, I think some people like who have aspirations get disappointed very easily in their bands break up.
We never aspired to anything.
Well, our goal was to be on Letterman back when like Letterman, like the band played with most of the, like only the singer and maybe a guitar player would be out. So you'd have to play with the Letterman band. Wanted, and that was like, that was our goal. And we unfortunately never realized that dream. Yeah. And that ship has sailed because yeah. Letterman isn't even on
it there. Is too late.
Our one dream has been crushed.
See you in 20.
Yeah, I'll see you in 20.